Welcome to Hood Politics. In this episode, I will be discussing the story of Cameron Terrell, also known as Milk or White Boy from the Rollin 90s neighborhood Crips, which is a gang located on the west side of South Central Los Angeles. The facts of the case are as follows. When the average person thinks of South Central Los Angeles, the things that often come to mind are crime, poverty, and gangs. But just outside of the boundaries of South Central lies an abundance of wealth. A few miles north are the streets of the Hollywood Hills and Beverly Hills. A few miles west lies the beach cities of Santa Monica, Venice, and Marina Del Rey. And just a few miles south are the upscale cities of Rolling Hills and Palos Verdes. Normally, these two worlds don't mix, but in 2017, a young man named Cameron Terrell made national headlines when he crossed that boundary and stepped into the Rollin' 90s, which is one of the most reputable gangs in South Central Los Angeles. Palos Verdes is an upscale city filled with cliffside homes, top-rated schools, golf courses, and country clubs. Cameron Terrell was raised here. His mother, Deborah Terrell, is an interior designer with a list of wealthy clients. His father, Donald Wayne Terrell, is president of New and Improved Media, a media consulting company based in El Segundo, California. The Terrell family lives in a 4,000 square foot home that is valued at around $1.8 million. They would often take lavish vacations and attend parties thrown by their wealthy clients and neighbors. Cameron drove a black Mercedes-Benz, wore designer clothes, and was given a healthy allowance. Cameron attended Palos Verdes High School, which is one of the top-rated schools in Southern California. By all accounts, the Terrell family was living the American dream, but behind closed doors, the family was in turmoil. Cameron and his parents didn't get along, which led to daily arguments. Cameron began to rebel against his parents and would often run away from home. There are a lot of rumors regarding Cameron and how he initially connected with people in South Central. Some say it was through drugs, and some say it was through social media. But one thing is clear, once Cameron made his way to South Central, he became infatuated with the streets. Cameron became good friends with one of the boys there. He would stay at his house for days, weeks, and months at a time, and would even call the boy's mother, Mom. Sometime later, the boy was being courted by the Rollin 90s Crips and told Cameron he should also join. Cameron jumped at the opportunity, and shortly afterwards, the two boys were initiated into the gang at Jesse Owens Park, which is a stronghold of the Rollin 90s. Cameron dove headfirst into the gang life. He was given the nicknames Milk, White Boy, and Bright Eyes. He would get clothing made with his gang and nickname in large letters. He even got a tattoo of the Washington Nationals logo on his chest, which is a logo the Rollin 90s adopted to represent Western Avenue, a street that stretches through the heart of their territory. It's safe to say that Cameron adapted to the gang lifestyle as the years went on. He was from Palos Verdes, but he called South Central home, and the Rollin 90s embraced him. It's been said that Cameron was no stranger to crime, and he indulged in everything the gang lifestyle had to offer. Things like drugs, robbery, and murder. On the morning of October 1st, 2017, Cameron and two other young men were riding in his black Mercedes-Benz. The group was armed as they entered the territory of a longtime rival gang, the A-Trey Gangster Crips. The rivalry between the Rollin 90s Crips and the A-Trey Gangster Crips goes back decades, and fights and shootings aren't uncommon between the neighboring gangs. Around 11:26 a.m., a 21-year-old man named Justin Holmes was walking down the street with two other people. As the group walked down 78th Street towards Western Avenue, they were approached by two men. The two men asked them what gang they were from. Holmes replied that he didn't gangbang. One of the men pulled out a chrome revolver from his sweater and began to open fire. Holmes was shot as the two people with him ran away. The suspects ran to a waiting black sedan and fled down an alley near Western Avenue. The two people that were walking with Holmes ran to a nearby store and called for help. They then returned to the scene of the shooting and stayed with Holmes until help arrived. Holmes was taken to the hospital and pronounced dead at 12:02 p.m. The autopsy would later show that he was shot twice, including a fatal shot to the back. Detectives working the case began their investigation. They began to look into the background of Holmes in an effort to find a motive for the murder. They found that Holmes nor the people he was walking with had any gang affiliation. Holmes was a college student and had a job working for U-Haul. He had a day off from work and decided to hang with some friends. One of the people with Holmes during the shooting picked out the gunman from a photographic lineup. The shooter was a 16-year-old gang member. Investigators then swept the area looking for other witnesses when they noticed a surveillance camera near the scene. They contacted the owner and asked for the camera footage. Upon reviewing the video, detectives saw the two suspects get into a waiting black Mercedes-Benz and speed off. Immediately, Cameron became a prime suspect. Police knew Cameron due to interactions at Jesse Owens Park in early 2017 and knew he drove a black Mercedes-Benz. Detectives interviewed Cameron about the murder. He admitted to driving the car at the time. Cameron was arrested on October 12th and his bail was set at $5 million. The two young men that were with Cameron were also arrested on October 12th. When the police searched the home of the shooter, they found a chrome 38 special revolver. He would later admit to shooting Holmes. The names of Cameron's accomplices weren't released because they were both minors at the time of the murder, whereas Cameron was 18 years old and legally an adult at the time of the murder. Cameron and his two co-defendants were charged with one count of premeditated murder and two counts of attempted murder with gang enhancements. The news of a wealthy white teen playing a part in the murder of an innocent black man in South Central quickly made national headlines. People wondered, how did this happen and what would be the outcome? Cameron sat in jail for about a week, but was released when his family posted $500,000 on the $5 million bond. Cameron's two accomplices remained in jail. Cameron's family was shunned by their Palos Verdes community. Clients stopped doing business with his family, and students, parents, and staff at Palos Verdes High School did not want Cameron to continue his senior year at the school, stating that they felt unsafe and uncomfortable with him attending. The school and the Terrell family agreed to let Cameron complete his studies off campus. Cameron pled not guilty to all charges, and his trial began on July 3rd, 2018. Cameron was represented by an attorney named Javon Blacknell. Blacknell told the court that Cameron was a good kid from a good home and the case was a result of blatant overcharging. He went on to say that Cameron didn't know the two men were armed when they entered his vehicle, and when he drove into rival gang territory, he thought the two men got out of the car to go tag a wall. Blacknell said that Cameron wouldn't have used his dad's car if he was planning to kill someone. He was shocked when he heard the gunfire. He stated that Cameron sped away as a matter of survival and not in an attempt to flee the scene of a crime. The prosecution painted Cameron as a wolf in sheep's clothing. They presented a stack of evidence in hopes of proving Cameron as an active member of the Rollin 90s and a willing participant in the murder of Justin Holmes. The evidence against Cameron included the following: a shirt with the name Milk in light blue letters, which was found in his Mercedes-Benz, pictures and videos of Cameron with known gang members wearing gang colors and throwing up gang signs, a Washington Nationals logo tattoo on Cameron's chest, which is meant to represent Western Avenue, a street that stretches through Rollin 90s territory. Other evidence included scenes from a music video called The NH Anthem. The NH Anthem is a song featuring rappers from various gangs under the neighborhood Crip umbrella. The rappers dissed rival gangs and showed their allegiance to the neighborhood Crips, hence the title, NH Anthem. Cameron can be spotted in multiple scenes of the video, amongst a sea of gang members, sporting a light blue bandana around his neck. The prosecution went on to explain that Cameron would have earned status among the Rollin 90s if he ventured into A-Trey gangster Crip territory and killed a rival gang member. The prosecution also showed a video that was taken by Cameron of gang members kicking over the candles at Justin Holmes Memorial. Javon Blacknell stated that Cameron was living a fantasy, and he was unaware of the real-life consequences of his choices. He went on to say that Cameron was influenced by music and movies. When asked about the tattoo on Cameron's chest, Blacknell said Cameron got the tattoo because Kevin Durant has one, and Durant is his favorite basketball player. Blacknell called character witnesses to testify on Cameron's behalf. All of them said they didn't think he would murder another human being. Jurors deliberated for nearly a week before reaching a verdict. The jury found Cameron Terrell not guilty on all charges. Cameron spoke to the press after the verdict.
I say rest in peace, Justin Holmes. He shouldn't have died that day. And, you know, I pray for his family every night. This has been weighing on me every single day of my life. So I don't have to explain myself to anyone. God knows what really happened that day, and God knows what was in my head that day.
The verdict caused national outrage and sparked conversations about white privilege and classism. A lot of people compared Cameron's case to the case of Ethan Couch. Ethan Couch was 16 years old when he decided to drive drunk. Ethan lost control of the vehicle and killed four people. During the trial, Ethan's lawyer argued that because the Couch family is so well off, Ethan never had to suffer consequences for his actions, so he didn't understand right from wrong. The attorney went on to say that Ethan suffered from a condition called affluenza. Ethan received 10 years of probation. Cameron's two co-defendants await trial. Since they were both 16 years old at the time of the murder, their cases went to juvenile court. The district attorney wants to move their cases to adult court so they can be tried as adults. I want to thank you guys for tuning in. Please like, comment, and subscribe.